because in the old LBW, they gave you both. And like in our communion liturgy, we have both for the Lord's Prayer, the traditional and this one. But we'll use this one the next 5 weeks. It's not a very radical difference from our usual Lord's Prayer. Then we do the Creed. Then we go to page 329 and we do the responses on the right hand side of the page and say it other times. Then page 330, we have a prayer, and then we have the readings and the hymns and the sermon, the offering, prayers, benediction, and the final hymn. So at this time, I would ask you to put a ribbon there, page 328. And at the same time, turn in the back of your hymnal to hymn number 324 as we begin our worship with singing In the Cross of Christ Thy Glory, hymn number 324.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is February 21st, 2018. This is our first Lenten service. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Pilate was crucified, died, and was buried. He at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Show us your mercy, O God.
And grant us your salvation.
Give us the joy of your saving help again.
And sustain us with your bountiful spirit.
Give peace in all the world.
For only in you can we live in safety.
Keep the nation under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth.
Your saving help among all nations.
Let not the needy be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in me a clean heart, O God.
And sustain me with your Holy Spirit.
Lord, hear my prayer.
And let my cry come before you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously protected us today. We ask you to forgive us all our sins where we have done wrong, and graciously to protect us tonight. Into your hands we commend ourselves, our bodies, our souls, and all that is ours. Let your holy angel be with us, so that the wicked foe may have no power over us. Amen. You may be seated. The reading for this evening is written in the fifth chapter of the Apostles' Letter to the Hebrews. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And with those who came without difficulty, please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 27th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. At about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of the bystanders hearing it said, this man is calling Elijah. And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink. But the other said, wait! Let us see whether Elijah will come to save him. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. The gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Just an announcement to share with you next week. Remember that there will not be a meal beforehand. We simply have the service beginning at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. Next week, our topic will be the suffering Savior. And the text will be Psalm 22, verses 12 to 19, if you wish to read ahead as we continue our look at the cross. Now let us sing, I Want Jesus to Walk With Me, hymn number 325. Back of the ocean.
Thank you.
Beginning of Psalm 22, we read the following words. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel, and you, our fathers trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him. For he delights in him. The great English evangelist C.H. Spurgeon, when commenting on these opening verses of the Psalm, the 22nd Psalm, said, quote, "This is most clearly the Psalm of the Cross. It is a photograph of our Lord's darkest hours. Oh, for grace to draw near and see this great sight," end of quote. Why was Jesus forsaken? It is something that sometimes Christians have a very hard time comprehending. Because Jesus taught us that his Father was a God of love. That his Father was one who wanted all people to be saved if they would just believe in his Son, Jesus Christ. That our Father allowed the rain to fall on the just and the unjust. So why would such a God forsake his own Son? Martin Luther, commenting on this psalm, said, quote, "God, forsaken of God, who can understand that?" End of quote. To begin to understand that, we have to look at the word forsaken and its meaning in Hebrew, and to remember God's plan of salvation. The word translated as forsaken means to abandon. It means to reject. It means to desert someone, to neglect them, to leave them behind. Why in the world would God abandon his own Son? Why would he reject his Son, desert his Son, neglect his Son, leave his Son behind? These words have been very troubling for some Christians. In order to try to soften the blow of them, when Jesus says this first line of the psalm, from the cross, the fourth word from the cross, they have tried to explain it, saying, well, Jesus was just repeating the words of this psalm for comfort. That he was remembering this psalm from his childhood when he would have learned it. And as a good Jew, he would have known it by heart. And so they say he was simply saying this for comfort. It reminds me of a story an Old Testament professor told us about the days he was a parish pastor before he became a seminary professor in the old Lutheran Church in America, and in the United Lutheran Church in America before that, when he would have been ordained and so forth. In order to preach in or teach in the seminary, even though you had your doctorate degree, you have to spend 5 years in a parish before you can become a seminary professor. So Dr. Seilhammer told us a story about when he was those 5 years in a parish. And he said one night he was in a hospital room with one of his parishioners who was dying. And he was holding the man's hand as he was uttering his last words, all in English. And then suddenly, out of the blue, he began to recite the words of a hymn in German, his native tongue, from the old country, which he had left years and years and years ago. At the Dr. Salinger asked the widow about this and told him about his experience, and she said, told Dr. Salinger how she remembered this happening only one time before. And that was when he had fallen out of the hayloft, landed on the tractor, and was seriously injured. And she said as they took him to the hospital in the ambulance and he thought he was going to die, he began to mutter that same hymn, the same words in German at that time. And so people who have had experiences like that look at Jesus' fourth word from the cross, they say, well, that's what Jesus was doing. He was looking for comfort in that song which he could learn. But that's not what the word forsaken is saying. The word forsaken is not saying Jesus is just remembering words from the past of comfort. We must remember that when John the Baptist first saw Jesus after his baptism, remember before Jesus' baptism, John the Baptist kept saying, there's one following me who is greater than I, whose sandal I'm not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal, and I baptize you with water. He's going to baptize you with fire and the Holy Spirit. And then one day we have that scene in the Gospel of John where John the Baptist is with Andrew and John and some of his other disciples, and Jesus comes walking along. And John the Baptist raises his hand and points his finger, and he says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Those words of John the Baptist give us a clue to what happened to Jesus that sixth hour on the cross when he said, my God, why has thou forsaken me? He was the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world. How are the sins of the world taken away? By the offering of a blood sacrifice. That is what the Jewish people did on the Day of Atonement, when they would make a national sacrifice to wipe away all their sins in the past year. And so sin must be paid for with blood. For that to happen, God had to reject his only Son in order that payment might be made in full for the sins of the world. So at that moment, for the sacrifice to be accepted, he had to abandon his Son. He had to reject him. He had to desert him. He had to neglect him. And he had to leave him behind, so that Jesus bore the full weight of the sins of the world then and until his return to give us salvation. We realize this more when we read the second part of the first verse, when the psalmist says, why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groan? That word saving means to rescue someone from a crisis, to deliver them, to give them salvation from punishment. The only way we could have salvation from punishment was for Jesus to be abandoned. If Jesus were not abandoned, we would have no forgiveness. We would have no salvation. We would have no promise of an earth, of a heavenly home that Jesus prepares for us, and that land that is fairer than death. So Jesus had to take the punishment that we are spared from. If Christ isn't forsaken at this moment by God, then we would have no hope. Jesus took our place. We deserved to be on that cross because of the sins that we committed. Some of you may remember the story of Father Kobe, although the further away in the past World War II goes, the less and less we hear about the heroic events of that great conflict. Father Kolbe was a Franciscan priest in Poland who was arrested by the Nazis after they invaded Poland a year or two after, or three after the invasion, and he was sent to a concentration camp for not cooperating with the Nazis and for speaking against the Nazis. And so he was sent to Auschwitz. And while he was in Auschwitz, one day 10 prisoners happened to escape. The deputy commandant of Auschwitz, in order to make a point, decided that 10 prisoners would be rounded up and starved to death as a sign to the rest of the prisoners, do not escape, or this is what happens to those you leave behind. So the deputy commandant began counting off 10 people, just haphazardly pointing to different men in the group. And he came to one man and pointed to him, and the man shouted out, "My wife and my children." With that, Father Kolbe stepped forward and said he would die in that man's place. So Father Kolbe and 9 other men were put in a bunker underground and starved to death. After 2 weeks, Father Kolbe was the only one left, because the Nazis now decided they needed to use that bunker for some reason. They gave Father Kolbe a shot of carbonic acid, which killed him immediately. Throughout that 2 weeks, it was said every time the Nazis looked into that bunker, Father Kolbe was either standing and praying or giving words of comfort to the other 9 men, or he was on his knees praying. Of course, because of this great act, he is a martyr of the church, canonized in the Catholic Church, and in the Lutheran and Anglican churches, we don't call him a saint, but we recognize him as a hero of the faith and have a commemoration for him on a day in our church calendar as well. What Father Kolbe did for that one man, Jesus did for all of us, because God abandoned, because God rejected, because God deserved, because God left him behind. Jesus had to be forsaken so that, being forsaken, we could trust in our Heavenly Father as Israel. In verses 4 and 5, we read, "In you, O our fathers, trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame." The word "trusted" that is used in this psalm here means to attach oneself to someone. It means to have confidence in someone. It means to feel secure in someone. And it means to feel safe. Israel, with their relationship with God, felt secure and safe. They had confidence in God. They attached themselves to God. We, being sinners, are afraid of God until we come to faith in Jesus Christ. Because Jesus was forsaken, then he becomes our door to a relationship with the Heavenly Father. And so at baptism, when we are baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, God the Father adopts us as his child and as a member of his kingdom. We are sealed by the cross of Christ forever to be his child forever. All because Jesus was forsaken. Because of that, we can have that same trust in God. We can have that same assurance. A train was traveling out west and a thunderstorm broke out. The lightning was flashing and the thunder was crashing and the wind was blowing and the train began to rock back and forth on its wheels as it clickety-clacked down the track. They began to go to a higher and higher elevation, and the higher they went, the more ferocious the wind seemed, more ferocious the lightning and the thunder. Most of the passengers
Even brave soldiers of our nation who had fought gallantly in wars were beginning to be upset. But in one car, there was a 7-year-old boy. He was sitting in a seat all by himself, playing with his toys, oblivious to everything around him. One businessman in that car, sitting a seat or two away from him, kept watching the little boy. And the more he watched him, the angrier he became. And the more annoyed he became, because this little boy was showing no fear, and everybody else was scared to death. And so he finally went up to the little boy, and he sat down beside him. He said, "Young man, are you not aware of the situation we're in?" The little boy looked up at him and said, "Yes, sir, we're riding through a thunderstorm." He said, "Well, aren't you afraid? Aren't you scared that the train's going to go off the track and we're going to plunge to our death?" The little boy looked up at the man and broke out into a big smile. He said, "No, sir, I'm not afraid of this train falling off the track. Because you see, my dad is the engineer of this train, and I know he will take us safely to our destination." By Jesus being forsaken that first Good Friday, we know that God is the engineer of our life, and that through our faith in Christ, he will take us safely to our destination, which is to live with him throughout eternity. The word translated as rescue means to escape from the threat of death. It means deliverance from affliction. The root word is from a noun that literally means the Lord who delivers. So when you're saying rescued, they're actually saying is the Lord who delivers. Jesus' death upon the cross assures us that he delivers us from sin, death, and the devil. His being forsaken, as I said, makes the payment for our sin accepted by God, our holy heavenly Father. And we are then delivered, not by what we do, but by everything God has done for us through his Son, Jesus Christ. Christ was forsaken, but he still trusted in his Father. And from Jesus we learn that when we face the storms of life, when we face the difficulties of life, when we feel death's grip upon us, that we too can still trust in our Father through Jesus Christ. Verse 8, we read, "He trusts in the Lord, let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him." Here the word trust means to commit one's life to the Lord. Jesus committed his life to God the Father. He committed his life to fulfilling God's plan of salvation. And we benefit from that. As followers of Jesus, then, we are called upon to commit our lives to following Jesus and to obey him, to continue that work that he began, that work of saving people through the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The word translated as rescue means to snatch away from someone. Or, more literally, it means spiritual salvation. And this is an important point, because too often, when people read Scripture and they read about God rescuing or God saving or God healing, too often they want to narrow that to mean that God is going to do something to save you or heal you or rescue you from something going on the earth. He's going to rescue you from the mugger. He's going to rescue you from the flood. He's going to rescue you from the lion that's chasing you back into a village. Scripture, it is talking about our spiritual lives, not our physical lives. Because as Jesus taught us, it is our spiritual life that is most important. Our physical life doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if we're rich or poor. It doesn't matter if we're educated or uneducated. It doesn't matter if we're strong or weak. What matters is our spiritual life. Do we have a relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ? Do we believe that Jesus' death upon the cross pays the debt of sin that we have? Do we believe that on that third day, Jesus literally rose bodily from that tomb and 40 days later ascended bodily into heaven so that we have victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil? That is being spirit, having spiritual salvation. It is our spiritual life that is most important. That's why Jesus told us not to store treasures on earth. Or not to be concerned about storing treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal. But instead store treasures in heaven. That is why he said it is easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Because too often those people's God is their wealth, their power, their prestige. But that is not eternal. The faith in Jesus Christ is eternal. It's like the saying I had Charlene put on our message board. I don't know if any of you have had a chance to read it yet. You have to hit the stoplight at the right time. But it says, a jog in the park may be good for your heart, but a walk with God is good for eternity. You know, jogging is a big thing. A lot of people jog because they think it's going to make them live longer, be healthy. But they sometimes forget that what good does it do to have a physically healthy body and a corrupted soul? A corrupted soul. And so that jog in the park is good, but that walk with God is much better because it ensures eternity. The word delight means to find pleasure in, to be pleased with, to have affection for, to have a strong positive attraction. God had all of this for his son Jesus, that he had to ignore for our salvation. Because Jesus was willing to do what his Father wanted, God now delights in us because of our faith in his Son. Jesus, forsaken by God, does seem confusing until we realize it was God's plan of salvation for the world, and it took place so that he could reach as many people as possible. Scripture tells us God doesn't want to condemn anybody. God doesn't want people to go to hell. He wants them to be saved. That is why salvation is so easy. It's not a bunch of rules. It's not a bunch of regulations. It's not a bunch of rituals and tradition. Simply, as Jesus said, believe in him. Whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. God didn't want a difficult plan. He wanted it simple. But because he wanted it simple, it cost him everything. It cost him forsaking his son at the most darkest hour. Forsaking him so that we might be his. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now have the collection of the offering. Thank you.
Let us pray. O Almighty God, Heavenly Father, who did appoint us to confess the name of your Son, to preach his death until he comes again, we come to your throne of grace humbly trusting in your mercy. We thank you that you have given us a high priest, even Jesus Christ, who knows our infirmities, having borne them, who understands our temptations, having endured them, and who learned obedience by the things which he suffered. O Lamb of God, who as a sacrifice was slain for the sins of the world, becoming the offer of eternal salvation to all who obey you, teach us obedience. Give us such faith that we may obey to the utmost all of your gracious and life-giving commands. Fill us with the true love of you, so that all fear of holy submission to your word is overcome. Grant us such trust that we, hearkening to your voice, may find the true joy of comforting, conforming our wills to your holy will. O Holy Spirit, if we are led into the wilderness of temptation, deliver us by your power and save us from all evil. Suffer us not in our times of testing to fall from your grace. Help us to wrestle daily against the powers of darkness, which manifest themselves in every circumstance or position in life. Overthrow the tempter, Satan, and every assault on our souls. Make us strong in you, and by the example of the Lord Jesus, show us the victorious power of your holy word. And as we of your church, O God, are tenderly permitted to be workers with you in the saving of people, grant that we may receive your grace for our own regeneration before we seek it for others. If there be any here in our midst who have not yet heeded your call, grant, O Lord, your power that they may on this day heartily repent, believe the gospel, and receive your mercy. Let your blessing rest upon our homes. Give all parents wisdom to see the influence of character and grace to be true followers of him who is the light of the world, so that by their manner of life and conversation, they may be worthy lights unto their children. Bestow your spirit upon our country, O Lord, that in every office and calling, by every human virtue and divine grace, we may show forth your praises, your power, and your glory. And for much and for as much as you did make the captain of our salvation perfect through suffering, if any among us be afflicted with suffering and pain, grant that they may learn of your love and receive your fatherly chastisement. If any be sorrowful, give them the comfort of your promises. If any be in need, show yourself the source of all good. If any be dying, give them the confidence that though the earthly house of this tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building of God eternal in the heavens. Now, O Father, give your angels charge over all your people to minister to their salvation and to bring them safely through this world to that eternal kingdom which you have prepared for all of us that love you. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior and Lord. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit keep you in his light and truth and love, now and forever. Through our worship this evening, we'll just keep Jesus keep me near the cross, hymn number 335 in the back of your worship, hymn number 335.
Thank you. be to God.
That concludes our Lenten evening service, the 21st of February. Join us Sunday at our 8 o'clock and 10:30 services here in the sanctuary, and next Wednesday, 2 o'clock in the chapel, and 7 o'clock again in the sanctuary, our second Lenten service. Again, join us on Sundays. Thank you for watching.